Shenoy sir, please do say, share the YouTube link as well.
Hi, Abhilasha, Vrinda.
Yes, sir.
Hello, sir.
Everybody present in the meeting, Varsha. We have Hirkani who is joined and so obviously Vrinda has created a flutter. So because submucous fibrosis is something which we come across very often. And that is something which we have to deal on a very routine basis, I think. Apart from third molars, fractures, and the next thing that we have to deal is submucous fibrosis, which is another pandemic in our country. Or rather, I would say not pandemic, an epidemic, right? So we have with us Dr. Vrinda Kolte, senior professor at VSPM Dental College. Very proficient surgeon, good clinician, an excellent academician. And I think Kshitij will have more details about her. So over to you, Kshitij, if you could introduce our speaker for today.
Good morning,
sir, all. You forgot to introduce our moderator, sir.
Yeah, Kshitij is the moderator. just 1 minute. Thank you. So, with me is Dr. Kshitij, who is the moderator for today's program. And Kshitij is also a very silent, smiling surgeon. So, there are three S's. He never gets angry. And he's a very pleasant personality. He's also a very good academician and a clinician. So, Kshitij, I hand over the stage to you.
Good afternoon all, and thank you, sir, for these kind words. And thank you for this opportunity to moderate this session. Today's topic of webinar is oral submucous fibrosis, and for this speaker is Dr. Vrinda Kolte. She is professor in the Department of Oral and Maxillofacial Surgery, VSPM Dental College. She has experience of more than 18 years. She worked extensively in trauma, in management of fibrosis and implantology. It's pleasure working with her since more than 10 years. And she is a very dynamic person, inspiration for all of us. She is always active and enthusiastic in doing new things. She will enlighten us about tips and tricks in managing these cases of oral submucous fibrosis. And I know that all will enjoy this session. It will be a pleasure listening to you, ma'am. Over to you, ma'am.
Yes. Thank you, Kshitij, so much for your kind and elaborate introduction of mine. Thank you, Shenoy sir, Abhilasha, and Manikar madam for giving me an opportunity to speak on this forum. Now I will start with my presentation. I chosen oral submucous fibrosis for presentation because, as sir rightly said, that it is the condition where we come across more often next to the trauma and impactions in our routine clinical practice. So it's mandatory for each and everyone to know the facts about the oral submucous fibrosis and some tactics to handle this condition. So I think I will be able to judge these questions through my presentation. So as we all know, oral submucous fibrosis is a potentially malignant disorder and which was described by Schwartz in 1952, who termed it as a atrophica idiopathica mucosa oris, and which was later by Pinberg in 1966 elaborately defined the oral submucous fibrosis, which till date is applicable and we are following. So the definition says it is an, each and every word of this definition is important as far as diagnosis and management is concerned. So to define, it is an insidious chronic disease that affects any part of the oral cavity and sometimes in advanced cases to the pharynx. And although occasionally it is preceded by or may be associated with some vesicles, and there is a juxtaepithelial inflammatory reaction which is followed by fibroelastic changes in the lamina propria, which is causing epithelial atrophy, and there is a stiffness of oral mucosa which is causing the prognosis of the trismus in as the disease progresses and which is leading to inability to eat for the patient. So each and every word we are considering when discussing this condition further. It is all as long if we go to the historical part, it is described by Sushruta himself, the similar condition which is showing narrowing of the mouth, there is burning and pain, who describe it as a vidari. So they are dealing with these conditions since the time of Sushrutas. Epidemiologically, this is the disease of the Asian subcontinent, and the Asian subcontinent, the population of the Asian subcontinent are only most of the population affected by oral submucous fibrosis, and the population which is migrated from Asia to other continents, they are also shown this. So it is termed as a disease of Asian subcontinent. Etiopathogenesis, it is a multifactorial complex phenomenon, not fully understood, but there are various theories have been put forward to describe the etiopathogenesis of the disease. But multifactorial origin is most of the authors or most of the surgeons, they accept their origin as a multifactorial disease. And there are two accepted facts for this. That is one, areca nut chewing is the most prominent factor among all the oral submucous fibrosis patients apart from other contributory factors. So areca nuts, they are available nowadays in various forms. Previous days, areca nut basically is a CNS stimulant. So the people used to eat this for getting feeling pleasure during their work and all, feeling euphoric. So when they are consuming small quantity, they act as a CNS stimulant. But because of marketing of this areca nut along with the combination of other betel nut and fancy gutkas, their advertisement in the medias, they had caused the significant rise in the cases of oral submucous fibrosis in the late 20th century. So this again supports the fact that OSMF is always associated with chewing of the areca nut in any of the forms. So it is very important that areca nut chewing history we will ask during the examination of this OSMF patient for our diagnosis. Then other contributory factors are always associated along with the areca nut chewing is chewing of the smokeless tobacco along with it, high intake of the chilies, toxic levels of copper in the foodstuffs, vitamin deficiencies, malnutrition associated with this patients, and the genetic predisposition. These are the some contributing factors which are related to this. Why we say there is a deficiency of this vitamin or the anemia is responsible, because in normal incidences, when body is subjected to certain trauma, there is body reacts to that and there is inflammatory reaction and body takes care of whatever irritation is caused to the body. But in OSMF, as there is a deficiency of these micronutrients, the defense mechanism of body somewhere fails and it responds by increase in the fibrosis. So that is why it is considered, and there are various articles that it is always associated with certain contributory factors. And of course, it is a disease of Asian subcontinent, so therefore there is some of the genetic predisposition of this Asian population is there, although it's not proved yet, and there are many studies going on for in this direction. The frequency, amount, and duration of areca nut chew definitely affects the area of the submucosa involved in the initial stages, and of course its progress of the disease. Because there are alkaloids which are present in this areca nut, that is arecoline, arecidine, arecolinidine. These are responsible for the chemical reaction with the mucosa, which are causing changes in the submucosa. So how much frequency, amount, and duration the patient is consuming betel and areca nut along with its combination will definitely depend on how much severity and how is the progression of the disease. Geographical distribution, I don't know it is a matter of pride to all of us or not, because we, the India, most likely the central India population is coming over on the world map because of the more incidence of oral submucous fibrosis and cancer. Nowadays, it is called as central India being a capital of oral cancers and oral submucous fibrosis. So we have to definitely think in direction right from the stage of prevention to the management. We have to learn, we have to master this task of managing the patients of oral submucous fibrosis. As I said, etiopathogenesis is a complex phenomenon. It is basically starts with the betel nut chewing along with the other contributory factors which we have seen. So betel nut not only causes the chemical irritation to the mucosa, but it also causes the mechanical irritation when patient chews the betel nut, because it has coarse fibers in it. So when patient chews it, it causes actually a microtrauma to the buccal mucosa, the gingiva, the tongue, which are part which is coming in contact. Patient usually keep a quid in certain part of the oral cavity. So there you can see there is a change in the color of the that mucosa because of the chemical as well as the mechanical irritation. And both this irritation, that is chemical and mechanical factor, synergistically act to diffuse the various chemicals which are leached out from the betel nut, which are responsible for the chronic inflammation. If you see histopathologically at the submucosal level, you see the chronic inflammatory changes which activate the macrophages, and they are responsible for deposition of the collagen fibrils, whereas their mechanism is deranged and there is much of the collagen fibril deposition in the submucosal level, which further causes the atrophy of the epithelium, which makes it again more susceptible to response to this kind of chemical or mechanical trauma, and this cycle goes on. So when you see histologically, most of the time oral mucosa is affected in, and in late stages the pharynx is also seen to be affected. Submucosal level, there is deposition of this collagen fibrils, they are dense collagen fibrils, these are seen, and in advanced stages we see there is loss of reticulocytes and there is atrophy of the epithelial mucosa. So it is making it more vulnerable to further chemical changes, and the process goes on, and the oral submucous fibrosis goes on in its intensity as the habit is continued. So there are number of classifications given in the literature. If you just go through the literature, there are different bases considered to classify this oral submucous fibrosis. So you can just go through these various classifications which I have just enumerated. Classification based on the clinical features, there are 8 to 10 classifications depending on these clinical stages. Then there are certain histopathological features which are considered. So Pinberg classification is one of the important of that. So you can just go through these articles in the literature. And the third classification is, it is based on the clinical and histological features which we as a surgeon, or when we are treating the disease, it's followed in a major number. So it is described by Khanna and Andrade in 1995, which we follow till date when we are managing these patients. So what this classification says, in group 1, we have the cases which has reported in very early stage of their disease, who had just the burning sensation and may complain of recurrent stomatitis. As of now, there is no change in the mouth opening. So here the history plays very important role, that patient has burning sensation, recurrent stomatitis, which may be there because of other systemic conditions also. But if the patient has a history of betel nut chewing, that will definitely direct you to consider OSMF as one of the factor for its differential diagnosis. Histologically, it shows the inflammatory cells and the epithelium at this stage is normal. So somewhere, if we consider this group 1 cases, that may be considered for some kind of medicinal treatment or conservative treatment as far as their management is concerned, as there is no change in the epithelium. Then group 2 cases are the cases where the buccal mucosa is already showing some changes, that is marble-like, or there is pallor is present in the buccal mucosa. Fibrosis, a generalized fibrosis or stiffness of oral mucosa can be palpable, and there is definite decrease in the mouth opening to 26 to 35 millimeters. So there is a definite change in the mouth opening. So these cases may be easier to diagnose as compared to the disease of that of group 1. Histologically, it shows juxtaepithelial hyalinization, and there is a flattening of the reticulocytes that shows that the epithelium has started undergoing atrophy, and so it is more vulnerable to the changes which are going to be further imparted by patient's habit, which is going to be continued. In group 3, they are labeled as a moderately advanced cases, as there is already a strismus where the mouth opening is in the range of 15 to 25. Buccal mucosa is showing definitely a pallor, and is firmly attached to the underlying tissues. So it causing the atrophy of the vermilion borders. The fibrous bands are palpable in the soft palate and in the retromolar region, the rapé area. These are the classical features of this stage. Then histologically, it shows again the hyalinization in the juxtaepithelial region, and there is atrophy of the retipex. Also, to a certain extent, the underlying muscle fibers are also getting involved in this stage 3. Then group 4A is an advanced stage where there is a severe trismus mouth opening is going just around 15 millimeter. There is a thickening of the bands. We can actually see those bands and palpate those. There is shrunken uvula. The tongue movement is also restricted. There may be circumoral bands also palpable, showing the changes in the vermilion of the lip. Group 4 are associated with the other associated diseases like OSMF with leukoplakia and squamous cell carcinoma. So this is considered as group 4B. And there is histopathologically, there are distinct features of urticaria and extensive degeneration of the underlying muscle fibers. So depending on this classification, we actually decide what type of treatment we want to do for that particular patient. So this is how we can describe patient has diffuse atrophy of the temporalis, as there is burning sensation. So patient tries to avoid chewing and try to take soft to semi-solid diet. So there is naturally atrophy of the temporalis, which is a classical feature. There is hollowing or the sunken cheek appearance for these patients because of, again, the fibrotic changes. Reduced mouth opening, a classical feature for submucous fibrosis. And when you ask patient to blow his cheek, he is unable to blow his cheek because he has lost the elasticity of his buccal mucosa. Then when you go to sign symptoms, this will definitely depend on at what stage the patient is reporting to you. Since this is the chronic progressive disease, the sign and symptoms for each and every stage are definitely different. In initial stages, patient may not have any extra oral features because patient will have only recurrent stomatitis, mouth opening is normal. But as the disease progresses, we can see features which are already described. In advanced cases, you can see that patient's vermilion border is altered. There is hollowing of the cheek. When you ask patient to open mouth, he is not at all give any opening of the mouth. So you are not able to examine the features like we described, the palatal changes, the changes of the tongue. So it is very difficult to examine this patient for intraoral examination. But definitely you can appreciate there are changes in the gingiva, changes in the buccal mucosa. If you palpate, you can actually feel the fibrous bands in this region. So whenever there is some mouth opening in stages 2 and 3, you can appreciate that the buccal mucosa is showing paler. It has a marble-like appearance. The anterior fossial pillar has also showing the changes. The palate is also showing the fibrosis and the sunken uvula, which is a classical sign of advanced stage of oral submucous fibrosis. And of course, as the patient has nil mouth opening, initially you notice the stains as the patient is not able to maintain his oral hygiene. Then blanching of this mucosa, paler, shrunken uvula. And in advanced cases, you can notice there is some change in the voice of the patient as nasopharynx is again getting affected. So there is dysphonia or nasal twang. In advanced stages, yes, in the literature, hearing impairment is also described. Burning sensation is there persistent from stage 1 to the advanced stage of this disease. Diagnosis of this oral submucosis fibrosis is mainly depending on the clinical features, because the patient, as it is a progressive disease, you may report the patient from stage 1 to stage 4. So diagnosis basically depends on thorough history regarding the betel nut chewing. And the clinical features, the classical clinical features should be there. Restricted mouth opening, the change in the mucosa as we have seen. And on palpation, you will feel the fibrous bands. And when we want to go for any surgical management of this patient, then we will get the OPG done. And then it will show, we basically evaluate this OPG in view of surgical treatment plan, that is, we want to go for coronadectomy and removal of the third molar. So we will examine OPG in that view in mind. Then treatment plan basically consists of counseling of the patient and to discontinue having. Because we know it is an insidious disease, we are not dealing with any type of management of oral submucous fibrosis as such. We are not dealing with the to reverse this oral submucous fibrosis changes. But what we are doing, we are just giving a symptomatic treatment to patient. The main symptom of this patient is restricted mouth opening. So what we are achieving is, we are just achieving a good mouth opening, and we want to make maintain it for long term. So we are reconstructing it with the help of various flaps available. And also we need a post-operative vigorous physiotherapy, and we have to follow them long term because the chances of malignant transformation are high for the oral submucous fibrosis. So two reasons we want a long term follow up. First is, we want to see that physiotherapy is being done generously or not. And secondly, we want to evaluate if there is any malignant transformation at the earliest stage. So first important is the counseling to discontinue habit. Even though it is not going to help to reverse the disease, but it will help to definitely add into whatever surgical procedure we are going to do. We definitely are going to add into benefits of this surgery. Then the OSMF, there are three types of treatment described in the literature. Medicinal, that is some application over the buccal mucosa, then intralesional injections therapy into the fibrous bands which are there, and the surgical management of this condition. Why we want to treat this patient? Because there is a, this treatment regime is suggested because if we are going to treat the patient, these patients are already having certain type of nutritional deficiency because long term patient is not able to take his routine diet. So we want to boost up that immune capacity of that patient by giving him a nutritional support. Then the physiotherapy is mandatory. By whatever modality we are treating this patient, the physiotherapy is mandatory. Then there are various local drugs have been tried to treat the patients. The combination drug therapies seem to be little useful than trying an individual drug in the local form. And when the disease is in advanced stages, definitely a surgical management is the treatment of choice, which again needs support from nutritional support to get the maximum result for this surgical procedure. So I'm just in short talking about the medicinal management of oral submucous fibrosis. Although it has a limited role in only initial stages of the disease, but the rationale behind this medicinal treatment is that when the there is some deficiency of the supplements in the body is going to not going to respond to any kind of trauma to it in a normal way. So there is much of a fibrous deposition, and therefore the reaction of body to the trauma is altered by depositing the fibers. So we are trying to consider various factors which deficiency may lead to the decrease in the defense mechanism of this patient. So there are various articles which have studied the role of antioxidants, various vitamin supplements, then immunized cow milk. So these are the articles. You may refer to this for the further elaborative study on this. All these drugs are basically directed to support the patient's immune potential or to suppress the inflammatory reaction which is induced because of this local irritants. So these are various drug tried, lycopene, which is also described very well in this article. These are various conservative treatment modalities which have been tried. Steroids, yes, again, it is a steroid has been tried in various forms from local applications to intralesional injections. There is a very good article by Dr. Borlesser regarding the management of OSMF on this steroid application. Please go through it. But mind me, all these drugs, the placental extracts, steroids, and ultrasonic rays, the turmeric use. These are all the treatment which are only useful in initial stages. It is not going to alter the disease, and only in very early stage it may just stop the progress of the disease, and it is going to be continued, and later stage patient may need the surgical management. But it will definitely help to divert the patient from conservative to surgical management, as patient will know that there is no use of this medicinal therapy, so surgical treatment is the only alternative for treating this patient. Why we want to treat this patient in initial stages also? Because we know that it is a chronic and insidious disease. It is not going to stop by any of the methods. So with time, it is going to cause much and much discomfort to the patient, which will cause further anxiety and stress, because there is a continuous burning sensation. Patient is not able to eat his normal fluid, normal food intake. Socially, he feels not to get into social functions, as not able to eat the foods by opening his mouth wide. So it will cause a low self-confidence, and automatically patient will try to isolate from the social activities, and it will further add into the stresses of this patient, which will again aid for the malignant transformation of oral submucous fibrosis. So this is a vicious cycle is going to follow. So we want to treat this patient at whichever stage they are going to report, and we are counseling them slowly to turn up for the surgical treatment. The surgical management is a definitive treatment to get the mouth opening. So any patient with mouth opening less than 25 millimeter has to be considered for the surgical treatment. What is our goal of this surgical treatment? As I am telling you repeatedly, we are not dealing with the treatment of the oral submucous fibrosis as such. But what we want to achieve is a mouth opening, and that to be maintained for a long term for that patient. So our primary goal is to open the mouth opening, so that it in turn will help the patient to improve his mastication, his phonation, and will maintain the oral hygiene, so that the chances of malignant transformation by all the supporting factors like nutritional support, the maintaining oral hygiene, it will improve the self-esteem of that patient, will help it somewhere. It's helping us to prevent its malignant transformation. And of course, we are aiming to prevent recurrence. I mean to say that the mouth opening which we are achieving, we want to maintain it long term. And for that, we are giving a physiotherapy to the patient, which is a vigorous physiotherapy, and we are following up that patient on a routine basis. So when we consider surgical treatment as such, there are two steps. First step involves to achieve a mouth opening. So it depends on at what stage the patient is reporting us. In initial stage 2 and 3, we can find the bands are present in the retromolar area only. But in advanced stages, there are periodontitis also. So we want to first achieve the mouth opening by releasing these fibrous bands. You may use the scalpel, cautery, or laser, whatever is available at our setup for releasing these bands, which is followed by a forceful mouth opening. And the coronadectomy procedure will again help us to increase the mouth opening. So these two procedures will help us to get the mouth opening. So once we do the mouth opening with the help of forceful mouth opening using the scalpel or blade, whatever, and the this surgical defect into the buccal mucosa. So if you leave it like that, it is going to again recur by healing by fibrosis. So we want to prevent that. So we have a various flaps which have been described in the literature to treat this surgical defect, which we want to reconstruct, or what we say it as a resurfacing of the defect, so that the healing is proper and the fibrosis is prevented. So there are local flaps described like the fat by tongue and palatal flaps, regional flaps like nasolabial, temporalis and platysma, and there are distant flaps have also been tried like a microvascular flaps for treating this oral submucous fibrosis. So we will see some of them in detail. As I have described you, surgical management starts with the release of the band. Either you use a scalpel or laser. So we start right from the retromolar region, the pterygomandibular raphe region. The incision is given at the level of the occlusal plane, starting from pterygomandibular raphe, just medial to malleolus. We are ending our incision. We have to take care of the sensus duct, which is there. we have to be just below that stenosis duct so that it should not be damaged. Once we do this release, just excuse me. Once we release this fibrosis, we are bilaterally doing this procedure on the right buccal mucosa and left, and then followed by a forceful mouth opening with the help of Ferguson's mouth gap. So you get some kind of mouth opening after doing this fibrotomy. Then the next stage involves is extension of that buccal incision posteriorly to expose the anterior border of the ramus, and we are doing the coronoidectomy by incising the coronoid process at its tip. With the help of various micromotors, osteotome, which are available, we are doing the coronoidectomy, which is again followed by a forceful mouth opening with the Ferguson, and you get adequate mouth opening after achieving your coronoidectomy. So now you can see that once we have done the fibrotomy and coronoidectomy, we are creating certain kind of surgical defect into the buccal mucosa, and we want to augment that. So whatever flap we feel suitable has to be used for reconstructing this area. So in the literature, buccal fat pad is one of the graft which has been tried. Buccal fat pad is a specialized fat pad. It is called, it is of a type Cicercosis, which is basically functioning for permitting the good movements in the intramuscular level. So this fat pad we are using to line the oral mucosa after resection of the fibrous band. To see it structurally, it has a main body and four extensions, that is the temporal, the pterygoid extensions, then the buccal extensions. These extensions are, this is how we are going in the superior direction from the incision, which we are used to release the fibrosis. We are retrieving the buccal fat pad along with its proper capsule. If it comes, we are able to retrieve this in a capsulated form, it is very easier to handle. But if by chance you break this capsule, then it becomes very difficult for management of this buccal fat pad and its suturing into the buccal mucosa. Then once we retrieve this buccal fat pad in the oral cavity, we spread it over the defect and we suture it with the help of vicryl sutures in the defect which we have created after fibrolysis of oral submucous fibrosis fibers. And this is how, this is the early post-operative, just after healing, you can appreciate there are some threads of the vicryl are seen, still seen, but it is nicely healed. In previous days, they used to use some kind of collagen sheet or skin grafts to cover this buccal fat pad. But with the studies, it has come to know that this buccal fat pad itself is going to get nicely mucolized. So there is no need of any further grafts to be combined with the with this type of grafts. And this is how you get the long-term mouth opening with the help of buccal fat pad. Of course, the post-operative vigorous physiotherapy has to be instigated as early as possible. And long-term patient is going to follow that at his home also to maintain this mouth opening in a long-term basis. The other flap described in the literature is the tongue flap. It is usually a posteriorly based tongue flap which is released and rotated to the buccal mucosa bilaterally. Although this flap is local and can be approached in an easier way, but in advanced cases, sometimes the tongue is also affected, and because of the surgical scarring, the tongue will show the further fibrosis. And in initial days, there is a morbidity like difficulty in chewing and speaking for the patient. So this flap is not much popularized, though it is available locally. You can appreciate here that there is a bulge which is present in the interocclusal position of this patient. So while chewing and while eating, the patient will have definitely a problem when you use this posteriorly based tongue flaps. Then most widely up till date flap is the nasolabial flap. So this is how nowadays the bilobe of nasolabial flap we are using. In previous days, it used to be inferiorly based. That is, the flap we were using is the inferiorly based. It was only one lobe, superior lobe. It was rotated into the oral cavity, and later on in second stage, this pedicle is separated from its underlying bed. But nowadays, we are using a bipedal flap, which has proven to be a high success rate for managing this oral submucous fibrosis patient. The procedure remains same. Fibrolysis followed by a forceful mouth opening, then coronoidectomy, and the mouth opening is achieved. Then we mark the flap, nasolabial flap. Here we start from the lateral part of the nose. It is enough for the patient with the oral submucous fibrosis. Then the medial incision line should follow the crease of the nasolabial fold of that particular patient, and that at the distance of 1.5 to 2 millimeter, you can mark the another line for its dissection. The pedal is maintained just lateral to the corner of the mouth, which is approximately around 1 centimeter in the size. This flap is, we start releasing it in the superior direction. We start releasing this flap from the superior direction. The depth of the flap should be skin, subcutaneous tissue, and little of the subcutaneous fat. We are staying above the muscular layer. So at this plane, we are dissecting the flap up to the corner of the mouth where its pedicle, which is based on the facial artery, is maintained. The lower part is also freed from its base, and then this flap is rotated intraorally to suture in its position. So the superior end of this flap is going into the distalmost part of the reconstruction site, that is in the retromolar region. The superior part is transposed, whereas the inferior most part is transposed in the anterior region in the medialis region. Nowadays, we are dividing the lower end into two parts, that is, we are making it as a fork flap, and we are suturing it into the medialis in a two direction, that is, Y-shaped incision is given around the medialis so that the medialis is preserved very well. So, and this is the follow-up. The hair growth indicates the flap has taken up nicely. And in long-term follow-up, you can see that the flap gets nicely mucolized. And when we suture this flap extraorally with the help of subcuticular sutures like this, with the help of subcuticular sutures bilaterally, the scar becomes more or less acceptable in a long run. This scar becomes inconspicuous in the nasolabial fold and becomes acceptable to that patient. So this is one of the article which is describing how the inferiorly based flap, which I was describing, it is inferiorly based. So here the pedicle is maintained, and in second stage this pedicle was again dissected from its base and sutured. But nowadays we are practicing it as a single stage procedure, which has a bilobed, or the two ends of the flap are separated at the same time. Although there are certain complications reported into the literature as far as this nasolabial flap is considered, but this can be overcome with the nice tissue handling, gentle tissue handling, and can be dealt when we are, this can be dealt very well clinically if at all it occurs. Platysmal flap, yes, there is a nice article by Dr. Datarkar and Dr. Bande regarding the platysmal flap used for oral submucous fibrosis. Personally, I haven't tried much. It is only in one case I have used where there was a recurrence of this patient who was previously treated at some other center with the help of nasolabial flap, and perioral fibrosis was there, which was restricting patient's mouth. So we designed this platysmal flap, which was dissected from his bed and transposed intraorally by creating a tunnel to the skin, and it is transposed intraorally. So this flap, I don't have much long or personal experience as far as this, but yes, it is described in the literature. Radial forearm flap, it is also one of the treatment described in the literature, but it, as we all know that microvascular surgery has its own limitations. So we have to be wise when to select or when to go for placing this radial forearm flap for this oral submucous fibrosis. So these are few comparative studies with the nasolabial flap and pre-forearm flap. Although it is going to be equally successful, but the surgical, the cost of the patient, the morbidity, all these factors will definitely make us to think whether to use it for radial forearm for the regular basis or not. So I would like to show you a small video of this nasolabial nasolabial flap for reconstruction of the oral submucous fibrosis. I think everybody of you can appreciate the video quality. So here we measured the preoperative mouth opening and we actually started the fibrolysis with the help of cautery. It's okay.
Video is not seen, huh? Video is not seen.
Okay, madam. Okay, share screen. Just give me some time. It's there. Now it's visible?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. So nasal labial flap, as it is most accepted, I thought I will show you some video so that newcomers can learn some technique by seeing this video. So this is how the fibers of the oral submucous fibrosis are dissected, starting from retromolar region, coming into anterior region. And with the help of artery or with the help of fingers, which we are breaking this oral submucous fibrosis fibers initially, which will be followed by, here we have to take care that we remain at the occlusal plane level in the buccal mucosa. This is how we get the forceful mouth opening with the help of Ferguson mouth gag bilaterally. We measure the mouth opening. Then we go for the coronoidectomy, the exposing of the coronoid process by extending the incision posteriorly. And with the help of the osteotomes and the burrs, we try to osteotomize the coronoid process from its base. Usually, we try to do the coronoidectomy for every patient. So this is how we get the coronoidectomy, which will add further, which will cause the temporal myotomy and which will help us to get the mouth opening further. Now we want to reconstruct the defect. So we are here planning for the nasolabial flap. So this is how we mark the initial line in the nasolabial fold. That is, the medial incision will lie in the nasolabial fold. The lateral incision will follow 1.5 to 2 centimeter away from the first incision. And we maintain the pedicle just beside this corner of the mouth of the patient. So here we can keep the weight up to 1.5 to 2. If we keep it more, it will be difficult to rotate this flap intraorally. And if we try to reduce it, the width of the pedicle or the width of the flap, it will compromise its blood supply. So 1 to 1.5 centimeter is an adequate width for that patient. Then we take the incision with the help of scalpel. Usually the dissection is preceded by infiltration with the help of saline or local anesthesia so that you get a nice plane for dissecting, as well as there is local hemostasis is good when you use the local anesthetic with the adrenaline. So all care is taken during marking and the dissection so that this pedicle is preserved, which is a, this is an axial pattern flap, but the blood supply is coming from the branches of the facial artery. See, from the superior aspect, we start the dissection slowly and the depth of the dissection is maintained at the subcutaneous flat level, that is the dermis and subdermal fat is incorporated into the flap. And the dissection is definitely limited above the muscular layer. See, once this flap, the depth of the dissection is marked, then we just go on releasing this flap till the base of this flap, which we have planned, which is just beside the corner of the mouth. So you can appreciate here, the muscle layer is there below. Above that, we are restricting our dissection just below the subdermal or subcutaneous fat level, we are restricting ourselves. This is how assistant will help by giving a little traction at the base, as well as it will help to achieve the hemostasis when we are dissecting this flap. This flap handling should be done very gently using some skin hooks and all, so that there is no much handling because it is going to compromise the blood supply if you are going to handle it more. Then the dissection, which is remaining at the inferior part of that flap, which we are dissecting from its bed. Similarly, we are trying to get into the plane, which is just below the subcutaneous part, leaving back the muscular layer. So depending on the need, we can actually measure how much length is needed for transposing, and accordingly we can plan our flap. But this type of long flap will help us to restore the defect right from the fascial pillar region or the soft palate region posteriorly to the anterior medialis region in the anterior part. So if we take it in such extensive manner, here we have created a window to transpose this flap into intraoral. See how this flap is secured at both the end with the help of suture, so that the rotation of this flap in the intraoral position is possible. Base, if it is wide, then we can reduce it so that the rotation of flap becomes easier into the, because finally we want to suture. See how the bilateral symmetrical incision is given, and now we are trying to transpose this into the intraoral position. So with the help of those threads which we are tied at both the ends, we are transposing this flap from extraoral to intraoral position. Note here that superior aspect is going in the posterior direction. The superior end of the flap is going in the retromolar region, whereas the anterior end is coming into the medialis region or anterior part of the oral commissure. So this is how this flap is rotated. This is the superior part. So we are trying to get it back in the posterior region. First, the superior aspect is transposed. Then the inferior part of the flap is transposed. And then we are just trying to get it adequately into the oral cavity without causing much damage to its pedicle and avoiding the kind of rotation. To avoid the rotation, we have to always reset in the anterior part of the incision which we have carried. See here the posterior part, we are trying to approach at the anterior fascial pillar or in the soft palate region, the first suture is given. And here the most tricky thing is to suture this flap into position. Release of the oral submucous fibrosis, preparing the flap is pretty much easier when you compare it with the, for the suturing of this flap into position. All the experienced surgeons who are there with me will agree for my this statement. As the mucosa is very atrophic, you usually get the sutures they are getting cut through. The approach is very difficult. The mucosa is very atrophic. So this is a very tricky part in this. So first we secure it posteriorly in the palatal region. Then slowly we go on suturing superior border, inferior border and in the anterior region. See how? Then the last part remains is we have transposed the flap. The extraoral scar we want to, extraoral incision we want to close by doing a undermining of the skin flap. Here we have to see that what your undermining is we are doing. We are restricting ourselves more of the undermining on the lateral side. On the lateral side, and we are not much involving on the medial side. So that this mouth opening or the, there should not be any flare of the ala or the mouth opening or the corner of the mouth will not be distorted. So we are restricting dissection at the lateral to the incision. Then we are practicing the subcuticular sutures for closing this incision which we have created for getting the nasolabial flap. Initially, there is to be the interrupted sutures which were used for suturing this, but nowadays with the help of this subcuticular sutures, scars are pretty acceptable. This is my team who is helping me to carry out my work. I'm thankful to each and everyone from my team. Thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am, for such a you covered the topic comprehensively, right from etiopathogenesis to stages, clinical features stage-wise, and treatment also stage-wise. And you have given tips and tricks in nasolabial flaps, how to take it. as this is a common entity which we encounter, so there are certain questions also from participants. So we will take questions.
Yes.
Like in the diagnosis, the question is, does biopsy is mandatory in OSMF for final diagnosis every time? Means before taking the case surgically,
yes.
Do we need to take biopsy?
Yes. It's not mandatory for all cases. Basically, the diagnosis depends on the clinical findings. There is well-established fibrosis is enough. But when you suspect some kind of malignant transformation, then there should be a definitive ruling out of that lesion preoperatively. But it is not mandatory when it is a clear-cut only oral submucous fibrosis.
Of
course, the institutional protocol may differ. In some institute, they may be practicing, but there is no such mandatory protocol for OSMF. I think I am pretty clear for this question.
I think Kshitij, hello.
Yeah, he has freezed. See Ashwini and Jigna.
Hello.
Yes, Kshitij.
Yeah. The next question is, ma'am, regarding role of MRI in OSMF cases.
MRI.
Do we need to take MRI in this?
Yes. I don't find any reference in the literature, nor I have any personal experience in this. So I think very limited role as far as OSMF itself is concerned. But if you are suspecting any kind of malignant changes, then definitely you may combine the MRI for managing this condition.
Right. Many of the questions you already answered, like the question from Varsha Manekar, ma'am, how to decide medicinal or surgical treatment. But you already explained 25 millimeter is the deciding thing.
Yes. Yeah. And it is an insidious disease. It's not going to stop by any kind of medication. What in initial stages if we get is just we are stopping that disease at that stage, that is only possible for stage one, that is also theoretically. Practically, there is no reference in the literature. So it is going to slowly progress to more advanced stages.
Brinda, hello.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, there was another question from Varsha, that is treatment of per oral bands.
Per oral bands, only per oral bands.
Yeah.
Okay.
So I think
per oral bands are usually associated with the bands in the retromolar region. So if it is the case that is stage 4 or stage 4, yes, if it is a stage 4, then definitely we have to definitely go for a surgical management.
Okay.
Can we take it? Yeah.
Yes.
One question from Dr. Abhilasha.
Yes.
Can buccal pad of fat be used where the fibrous band extend anteriorly till corner of mouth?
Yes, Abhilasha, that is the limitation of buccal fat pad actually. It is in early stages when there is only fibrous band in the retromolar region, it has to be proven effective. In the literature, if you go, they have tried to combine buccal fat pad with the help of split thickness skin graft, with the collagen graft, so that the anterior defect is dealt with. But it has no long-term success if you see that patient as far as his mouth opening is concerned. So it should be only choice of treatment when only a retromolar bands are there. This is my personal opinion for this.
Yes, ma'am. One question regarding physiotherapy. Usually we give with the Histergag. If the patient is edentulous, then how to give the physiotherapy? That is one question.
Yeah, good question. Not came across this situation till now.
Yes,
but it is going to be problematic. So we have to find out some solution by keeping the gauze pads or maybe...
If you permit, ma'am, can I answer this question?
Yes. Please, Apilasha. If you have experience in this matter, please.
Yes, ma'am. As you rightly said, you can place gauze pads on your histers or your jaw openers, and that can be done. Apart from that, you can make acrylic impressions yeah, you can take and you can make acrylic. Yeah, it was a technical note from our college.
That was my next solution to the problem, making just acrylic plates so that the mucosa is spared from any kind of damage.
Exactly. Yes. And apart from that, even you can use your impression compound.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yes.
There was one question, Kshitij, if I can ask. Hello.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so this question comes from Deblina. She says, this is a somewhat, I don't know whether it's a, we can answer it correctly. She says, what is the duration? What about the duration? What is the duration following which the patient can develop submucous fibrosis? I think that's a based on individual susceptibility.
Patients' nutritional status, their chewing habit, all these factors are contributing.
Yes.
Yeah.
One more question, ma'am. The fibrosis because of radiation. Yes. Your experience in such cases?
Not much of the experience, but yes, there is going to be a fibrosis post radiation. So as long as patient is under radiation therapy, you can give some medicinal treatment, as I think, though it has limited role. But the if the fibrosis is associated with mucositis and all, that can be taken care of. And some kind of physiotherapy in initial stages. That once the radiotherapy is over and still the restriction and the fibrosis can be failed, then that can be dealt later on.
What is the what is Kshitij? I cannot forward the questions to all of them, so I can ask a few.
Yes, sir.
Yes.
What is the technique of giving intralesional injection? And the somebody else is also asking. Kriti is asking. What is the protocol for hyaluronidase combined with dexamethasone? So correct technique of intralesional injection as well as hyaluronidase with dexamethasone. There are two separate questions asked by.
Yes, intralesional injections, they are injected directly into the fibrous bands. Usually the bi-weekly injections on either side in the same sitting is given, and bi-weekly this procedure is repeated, and which is associated with the physiotherapy, which is mandatory for this.
Brinda, how long should we give physiotherapy following surgery?
Following surgery, active physiotherapy for first 6 weeks under your monitoring. And then once the patient is trained for that, then he will have to continue with some kind of physiotherapy for a longer duration. And patient should be under follow-up whether he is following that or not. We have to notice at early stage if it is discontinued. But active physiotherapy for first 4 to 6 weeks.
Yeah, minimum 6 months long term.
Yeah.
You know,
at home, he has to continue.
Oh, there's one thing that I'm observing here, which is a very good thing actually. We should always encourage, ask questions. So the advantage of webinar is that the students can ask a lot of questions by putting it in the chat box, which is not a feature in the regular web conferences, where I think they feel shy of asking questions. So this is a very good mechanism by which they can ask questions. And Abhilasha went a step ahead that I think her students put questions to her and then she asked the questions first. So that is how it is actually. Okay. Yes. Rakesh is asking if we are treating submucous fibrosis patient with intralesional injections, what is the duration it should be continued?
Yeah, this is a very tricky question actually. In initial stages only you get some results. So ideally it is up to 3 to 6 months along with physiotherapy. You have to again evaluate whether we are getting some positive results or not. If not, then we have to definitely think of some kind of surgical treatment. I think Kshitij will agree with me for this.
Yes, ma'am.
I can add something?
Yes.
Go ahead.
Yeah, according to a paper by Dr. Borle, R.M. Borle, there was a paper in which he mentioned that due to intralesional injections, itself it causes fibrosis over a due period of time because of multiple pricks. So as such, it is not a permanent way by which it can be treated.
Yes.
It is only beneficial in cases where wherein you have grade 1, 2 or you can say grade 3 OSMF.
And multiple injections. At my level, I consider it as a just a treatment to counsel patient for the surgical management.
So that the patient
is with follow-up for us. He start with his physiotherapy and he himself sees that there is no much relief with the help of this conservative therapy and he becomes motivated for further surgical management where we need much of the cooperation from patient side for post-operative physiotherapy. So I think that is the first step to counsel this patient for surgical procedure.
Brinda, we are very honored to have,
Yes, sir.
We are very honored to have Dabir sir who has joined to listen to you.
So, okay, thank you so much, sir. Thank you for sparing time for me.
Yes.
I'm honored. I like your presentation, crisp and short
thank
and
you so much,
perfect.
Yes, thank you so much, sir, for your kind words.
Yes. Sir has been a role model for a lot of people.
Yeah, of course.
No, I'm just one of you. I'm still learning, please.
So that's your greatness, sir.
Yes, definitely.
That's the truth. That is the truth, really. Okay.
We are getting ourselves motivated with your this gesture, sir.
Thank you. God bless you. Okay.
Brinda, there is a question from Soumendra. He says, in one case, they had done where after 2 weeks of procedure, that is, they had used buccal fat pad, they noticed submandibular lymph nodes. And I think, can you say something about it?
Yes. There are two possibilities. Yes, sir.
Go ahead, Brinda.
Yes. There are two possibilities of developing the submandibular lymph node. Preoperatively, we make sure that there are no changes of the malignant changes which we should notice preoperatively. So if it is not there, then only we are treating oral submucous fibrosis. So there are two possibilities. One, there could be some inflammation which is causing the submandibular lymph node to be palpable, or there is other possibility of some kind of malignant transformation in some part of the oral mucosa. So both way we have to deal. And we have to make it more confirmed by taking some aspiration biopsy or further investigations regarding that.
Okay. Zaresh wants to know in how to measure a mouth opening in partially or edentulously patient having SMF. How would you measure the interincisal?
Yes. Yes, these are the cases which are dealt very rarely. So therefore, at least I could not find any reference in the literature. But we can measure preoperative and postoperative mouth opening, how much difference we can find it out. There is no guideline as such in the literature.
Linda, any experience regarding amniotic membrane?
Experience you are asking?
Yes.
No personal experience as such, but in literature they have tried it, but no long-term follow-ups these are available. Processing of this amniotic membrane and it needs a specialized team to assess. So it needs a good backup of this team, and there is no long-term follow-up these cases.
Correct. The questions are coming thick and fast, so I think I may have to ask.
So many questions.
Yes, so that speaks volumes about how effective you were as a speaker.
It is the other way also, sir. I could not explain it properly, so therefore many questions.
Because when you have a talk and it throws up a lot of questions, it's an indication that
Take it positively.
People are attentive.
Yes.
Yeah. I don't know. Payal has asked one question about coronoidectomy and coronoidotomy. So
coronoidectomy means actually we are taking out the coronoid process After freeing its attachment of the temporalis muscle, so we are actually taking it out bilaterally, and coronoidectomy is we are just incising or separating it from its base, and the this coronoid process will be left along with its muscular attachment there. So that is the difference.
I read sometime back about this the amniotic method. It acts basically as a dressing. So that is essentially
what we maybe tried as a dressing, yes.
We have not used it in our center very often.
Biological dressing.
Biological dressing.
And it requires ethical clearance also, sir.
Yeah, there are so many formalities for that.
There's one question which I think I can answer because it's a simple one. The complicated ones I pass on to you. So the question is that what is the prognosis if the patient is reluctant for post-operative physiotherapy? Let me answer this. It's very bad because they have to undergo physiotherapy. And we had a case in our own unit where first the patient was treated with a buccal fat pad. The patient didn't do physiotherapy, continued his habits. Then a nasolabial flap was done. Again, it happened. The recurrence happened. And the third time, I think we did a submental flap and we warned the patient that after this, there is no more options for him. So, and speaking of submental flaps, I think that made Pushkar Gadre get into your talk. Are you there, Pushkar? Pushkar Gadre was there. I think I saw him.
Yes.
He left, sir.
Okay. So he was there. One last question, actually, and then I think we'll. I think Brinda, you can message to Brinda later, or you can send it. What is the difference between temporalis myotomy and coronoidectomy in submucous fibrosis treatment? I think temporalis. You have just answered it.
Yeah, I answered that.
Temporalis myotomy and coronoidectomy.
Yes, basically, we are doing coronoidectomy to achieve temporalis myotomy.
Yes. So, I think that is quite. We have another more thing. Post-operatively after surgery, is there any improvement in the atrophy of temporalis muscle? Well, I think that depends on how well the patient uses the mouth opening. If I'm not wrong, that is the way it should be answered. Because at the end of it, it might undergo disuse atrophy.
Yeah.
Okay, Brinda. Thank you so much. And as usual, I have a big task to be done. That is to honor our speakers. Brinda, thank you so much.
Thank you so much, sir, and your team.
The taken. And of course, we saw a record 100 participants plus people waiting in the room, actually. So that means, as Varsha had said earlier, that you will rock and you have done it. And this is for the wonderful moderation done by Dr. Kshitij Bang. One thing before we wind up, is, I think many of you interact through that group, OMFS India. Now I've got confused so much here. There are different groups. So whatever is there, you can just put your, the webinar that you would like us to host, right, in the days to come. So that will be beneficial for us as well as for us. And after all, we are there. So, thank you, attendees, for coming over here and encouraging us. Brinda, you did a great job. Kshitij, you also did a wonderful job. And all the back office guys who were there. So, thank you, everybody. I would like also to thank the CIMS webinar team, Varsha, Brinda, Abhilasha, and of course, I only create the link. I don't do anything. So that was a great job that all of us did, and teamwork is definitely something that I always surgery. Not going to take much
thank
time.
Thank you so much, sir.
I would also like to thank our PGs who keep running around and doing everything for us. So thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am. Nice presentation.
Thank you, Abhilasha.
Century.
Very nice presentation, Runda.
Thank you, madam.
So, wonderful. And hope to see you soon, everybody. Thank you.
Yes, in person.
Yes.
Yes.
Okay.
Okay, bye. Give us a take care.
The link will be put on YouTube very soon.
Thank you.